Weeks I had the privilege of studying Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 1 to 11, and got to preach it for class, and now I'm going to modify a bit and try something new where preach Ecclesiastes and yet tie it in with what we're learning today in Mark. So to do that, yeah, it's if anything good comes out of this next 20, 30 minutes, it's only because of God, so you give him the glory. But I look forward to seeing what God is going to do and share from this passage. So if you have your Bibles, if you could turn to Ecclesiastes chapter 1. This book is right after the book of Proverbs. Ecclesiastes chapter 1. Why this passage, and why I try to tie into what we're studying today? Because as the author, Solomon, writes in Ecclesiastes 1, vanity of vanities, vanity of vanities. All is vanity. All is meaningless. All is empty, soon to disappear quickly, apart from knowing God. So if you have your Bibles, if you can, if those are able, please stand with me for the reading of God's Word. We'll look at verses 1 to 11 and tie it into our passage today in Mark chapter 6, verses 53 to 56. So Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 1 to 11. God's word says, "The words of the preacher, the son of David, king in Jerusalem. Vanity of vanities, says the preacher. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity. What advantage does man have in all his labor, in which he labors under the sun? A generation goes and a generation comes, but the earth stands forever. Also, the sun rises and the sun sets, and hastening to its place, it rises there again. Going toward the south, then circling toward the north, the wind goes circling along, and on its circular courses, the wind returns. All the rivers go into the sea, yet the sea is not full. To the place where the rivers go, there they continually go. All things are wearisome. Man is not able to speak of it. The eye is not satisfied of seeing, nor is the ear filled of hearing. That which has been is that which will be, and that which has been done is that which will be done. So there is nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which one might say, 'See this, it is new'? Already it has been for ages, which were before us. There is no remembrance of earlier things, and also of the later things which will be, there will be for them no remembrance among those who will come later still." Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you for the privilege it is to study your word. Even now, I pray that you'd keep this exhortation to the point. Help the words be an encouragement to all who hear. Help us, Father, to understand the meaningless of life and to understand, help us to not miss the point of life, miss the point of every second of our lives, miss the point of why you made us and put us here. So, Father, encourage my brothers and sisters, save those who don't know you. And Father, would this just be an encouragement for us to meditate on these truths and tie it in, help us to tie it in to the end of Mark 6, if that is your will. We pray and ask all this in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Here's a short introduction question for you to think about. If you could have anything you want, if you could have anything you desire to taste, touch, feel, smell, anything, all the senses, anything you desire, hold, have, dream about. If you could have anything you want for the rest of your life, but not have God, would you take this offer? As Christians, obvious, the answer should be obvious. No, God is most precious to us. But for most of the world, the majority of the world, and perhaps even some of us sometimes, our answer would be, yes, I would rather have the things of this world, my immediate desires, wants met, and God could just be out of the picture at this time. An example of this would be the lottery. Just this week, I was walking by this Filipino supermarket, and there was someone scratching his lottery ticket. For those of you who don't know, the lottery, you buy a ticket, you pay money to try to win a lot of money. And only one person out of millions and millions of people will win this amount of money. And it's supposed to make you happy, all the advertisements for the lottery is about the beach, about beautiful buildings, about travel, about delicious food. But something to think about for the lottery, when you watch these advertisements, have you ever thought they never seem to share testimonies of previous lottery winners? Wouldn't it be effective to have someone say, I won the lottery and life is so good, I'm so happy. But looking online, if you just Google lottery winners, you'll often come across news articles of people whose lives did change, but for the worse. Many people who, after they won the lottery and got all the money they could ever dream of having, just in a short time, they lose it all. And one example, I was reading a story of someone who won, and his family became very wealthy. They got to do everything they want, but they started getting bored with the things of this life. So they started moving on to different experiences, moving on to drugs. And eventually, one of his children died of a drug overdose. And while crying, weeping, this person said, if I could go back in time to when I won the lottery, I wish I had torn that ticket up. I wish I had torn that ticket up. It has destroyed my family. My family is no longer the way it was before. And here in this passage, in Ecclesiastes chapter 1, the author is Solomon. This is King Solomon, the one who was from birth. He was already in royalty. His father was the famous King David, the one who defeated all his enemies with the help of God, the one who was a man after God's own heart. Solomon would then become the king, of course, through trials and turmoil. His older brother tried to take the kingdom, and there were other enemies in life. But eventually, God removed all the enemies. Solomon was king, and God asked Solomon one question. What do you desire? Solomon, at this point, as a young man, he knew he lacked wisdom. So he asked God for wisdom, and God was pleased with the answer. God loved Solomon. Actually, Solomon's other name before he was born is Jedidiah, which means loved by God. Think about that. This is a man loved by God. His father David was a man who loved God, but Solomon was a man loved by God. So God gave him wisdom, but he said, because you asked for wisdom and not for riches or the life of your enemies, I'm also going to give you all these other things. I'm going to give you power, give you all the money in the world, so much so that silver in his kingdom was as common as rocks. Can you imagine if we just had silver lying around? It's like, it's a waste of time to bend down and pick up that silver because there's so much of it. This is the man who had it all. And once he had it all, he began to drift away from God. He, with his great wisdom, he began to experiment with life. What else can satisfy in this life besides God? He tried everything from good things, building great works, to also wicked things. Whatever evil, sins, lusts he desired, he didn't stop at them. In the end, he had 700 wives, 300 concubines. He had anything a man could think of. And this is the man who wrote this book to us. At the end of his life, now old, now perhaps coming to the end of his life, something interesting about Solomon, he reigned for 40 years. When he became king, he was only 12, 14. So he was actually not relatively young, but he also wasn't very old when he died after 40 years. But at the end of his life, when he looked back on his life and everything that he'd done, he says, everything is vanity of vanities, vanity of vanities. All is vanity. All is empty, meaningless, brief in this life. There's nothing that you should pursue in this life. It's all empty if you were to pursue the things of the world. Let's see some of the illustrations he gives us to show us that nothing matters. Nothing matters apart from God. Apart from God doesn't mean these people don't believe in God. Actually, in Solomon's time, the people very much believed in God. The question is, which God? There were his enemies, all the other nations who worshiped the lower G gods, all the false gods of the world. But there was also the people of Israel who worshiped the true Yahweh. They followed him. They knew his law from Genesis to all the way to Ecclesiastes. But did they know God in a relationship? And nothing matters. Nothing has meaning if you don't know God in a saving way, in a relationship. So that's what he's going to start telling us in verse 3. What advantage does man have in all his labor in which he labors under the sun? Under the sun, again, this is talking about life horizontal. If you were to live this life apart from God, or you know that God is there, but he and you have no relationship. He's just kind of like the God who sets the world in motion and then steps away. What advantage does man have in all his toil, in all his work, in all his life? He starts to explain in verse 4. A generation goes and a generation comes, but the earth stands forever. It seems like nothing changes. Though thousands of years go and go and go, all it is the old people pass away, and the young ones are born, grow up, then they become old, and then they pass away. And this is a constant cycle in life. It just seems like there's nothing new, nothing changing in life. Then the next verse, 5, also, the sun rises and the sun sets, and hastening to its place, it rises there again. It's like watching the sun. The sun's going around, then it becomes night. Then what happens the next day? And then the next day, and on and on and on. It's just an endless cycle. The sun's just running on a cycle. It seems to have no purpose, have no meaning. It's not one day the sun's finished going up and down and never needs to go up and down again. No, the sun seems to, when we look at it from our perspective on the earth, it just seems to run its race with no end. Like a hamster on a hamster wheel. It's running, it's spending energy, but it's not going anywhere. Going toward the south, then circling toward the north, the wind goes circling along, and on its circular courses, the wind returns. Also the wind blows from different places, but it seems to go nowhere. Then the last thing Solomon uses illustration from nature, verse 7, all the rivers go into the sea, yet the sea is not full, to the place where the rivers go, there they continually go. This isn't talking about the water cycle. If you study science, it's not saying, you know, water, it evaporates, goes into the sky, comes back down in the rivers. This is talking about how no matter how much the river flows into the ocean, it's never enough. It's never as if the ocean says, oh, stop, okay, that's enough water. I don't need any more water. The rivers just keep flowing and it seems nothing is accomplished. Nothing is done. It's like when you're at the beach, by the beach near the water, like we'll go next week. Try digging a hole, right? I'm going to make a hole. I'm going to dig a hole to China or something. You dig a hole, and what happens when the wave runs over the hole? It starts filling up, and it feels like all your work was useless. You try to build a sandcastle, build a wall to block the ocean from coming in. Eventually, the waves just wash over the sand, and it's almost like nothing happened. All your energy that you spent, kids, it was fun, so it wasn't a waste of time, but if you're literally trying to make a wall of sand, it is a waste of time because it doesn't work. It can't block the ocean. All these imagery about nature, it should remind us, perhaps Solomon is helping us to remember of a time in the past when God first created the heavens and the earth, when God created the sun, the earth, the wind, the waves, the ocean, the air, and God made Eden. God made the first man and woman, Adam and Eve, in the Garden of Eden. And they had everything they could ever want. And yet, they, like Solomon, they started to see and doubt God. Perhaps God is holding off on something good for us. There's something more than just what he's given to us. That's what the lie Satan told Adam and Eve. And they chose to believe Satan over God. And think about this. If they, after sinning against God and being separated from God, if they were able to eat from the other tree, do you remember what the other tree was? The tree of life. If they ate from the tree of good and evil, so now they know good and evil and they know sin because they sinned against God. If they were to eat from the tree of life and live forever and never die, that would be a living hell. It would be a life, again, where at first they have the whole earth to them. All things, but in a cursed world and they live forever, it would be hell because eventually everything God makes can never satisfy. And I'll go back to this point as we go on to verse 8. All things are wearisome. Man is not able to speak of it. The eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor is the ear filled of hearing. This is talking about if a man is to describe to you nature, everything Solomon just talked about, eventually it's going to become so boring. The water flows into the ocean. The water flows into the ocean. Can you imagine watching the Weather Channel on a marathon for the summer in California? The sun is up. The sun is hot. Stay indoors. The sun is up. The sun is hot. Stay indoors. The sun, every day he's gonna say that he or she will say the same thing. The sun is hot. Eventually you're gonna be like, this is so boring. I don't wanna watch the Weather Channel anymore. And that's what it's explaining here, that all things are worrisome, so meaningless, so boring that even you'll get tired of saying the same thing. If I ask you, hey, Jesse, tell us the weather for the next 100 days, right? The sun. Eventually Jesse's gonna be like, I give up. Let's do something else. This is extremely boring. And it goes on to show you the eye is not satisfied. Nor is the ear filled of hearing. Eventually, everything that we enjoy in this life, given enough time, apart from God, will become nothing. Your favorite foods, if you were to eat them for a whole month, you probably would not want to eat that food again at the end of the month. Your favorite music, your favorite song that you listen to, listen to it 1,000 times on repeat, and eventually at some point you'll think, I want to listen to a different song. And again, this goes back to the Garden of Eden. If they were able to eat from the tree of life and live forever, apart from God, there would be no more hope. They could never be reconciled to God because they would never be freed from this earthly life, from this earthly body, if there was no death, if they were not allowed to die. But God in His mercy, He kept them away from the tree of life. Let's keep going. Verse 9. That which has been is that which will be, and that which has been done is that which will be done. Life will go on again and again with no end to the cycle. Everything that's been done in the past is all that will be done in the future. For those of you who've read and studied history books, you'll eventually realize nothing repeats in history. It's all the same. The same invasions and wars and famines and earthquakes that happened in the past is the same that's happening today, the same that will happen 100 years from now if the Lord has not returned yet. There's nothing new under the sun. Verse 10, is there anything of which one might say, see this, it is new. Already it has been for ages which were before us. Though we might have technology that has never been seen in the world, for instance, the last couple decades, many people have cell phones now. We have laptop computers. We have the internet. And yet, is it really new? Is it really helping us to improve as humans? Actually, I would disagree. Remember, back then, you weren't considered a serious Christian in the early church unless you had memorized the whole Gospel of Mark. Now, when's the last time we memorized one chapter of the Bible? When's the last time we memorized one verse of the Bible? Our technology is actually not making us smarter. It's making us very forgetful, very just not able to focus a long time like before. Remember Adam, how smart was he? The very first man God created. And one day, God used him to name all the animals, all the fish, all the birds, all the plants in one day. How long does it take you to name your pet? Maybe a whole day just to think of a name. And even for as you decided on the name for your child, right? It took many days. So look how far we had fallen from who Adam was and who we are today. We have not gotten smarter. Nothing has been new. It's all been done. And finally, verse 11, there is no remembrance of earlier things, and also of the later things which will be, there will be for them no remembrance among those who will come later still. King Solomon, at the height of his power, he was the wisest king, most powerful king. All the world, all the earth was going to him for wisdom. Today, go and talk to anyone at your workplace, at school. Do you know who Solomon is? What? No? There is coming a time where anything we do, it will not be remembered by the next generation. Again, and just thinking about that, this is life apart from God. or even life where you believe in God, but you have no relationship with Him. And thinking, going back to the passage we studied today in Mark chapter 6, these people, the crowds, they were coming to Jesus to be healed. They were living for the here and now. They wanted life, they wanted healing, they wanted to live a good life on the earth. All of them were seeking Jesus for healing, but they weren't, none of them were seeking Jesus for salvation. And again, this is the, if Solomon is saying, if you are able to have everything they asked for, Jesus, heal me, Jesus, feed me, Jesus, give us the power to rule this earth. If that's all they had on this life, on this earth, eventually it would all become nothing. It would mean nothing. They would not even care at all. It would not satisfy them. Nothing in this life can satisfy. Nothing matters in this life apart from God. And something to think about for you, for me, for those in here who do not know God as their King, as their Lord and Savior. What do you live for? What do you desire to have in this life? Money, power, relationships, influence, anything you could think of apart from God. Eventually, once you get there, Solomon says he's been there, done that, and it's all empty. It has no meaning, no purpose. No, it does not fulfill you. You are not satisfied. And that is what sin does if we desire anything apart from God. And if you choose those things, you may have all the world, but what's that saying in the New Testament? How did Satan tempt Jesus in the wilderness? You can have all the world, all the kingdoms, if you just bow down to me. And there's the saying, what does a man profit if you gain the whole world and yet lose your soul? Again, kids, I know from your age, I didn't think about these questions at your age. But consider, if your parents allowed you to eat whatever you wanted to eat all the time, do you think you'd be happy? It would be done? Drink Coke every meal, eat chocolates, as many as you want. Have you tried that before? If you try eating chocolate to the point where you want to throw up, it's not a good feeling. And nothing in this world apart from God can satisfy. But, so what is the answer that Solomon gives to us? What is the answer that Jesus gives to us in the future? What do the people who are seeking Jesus in Mark chapter 6, what do they truly need? They're missing the point. They need to know that everything only matters with God, in a relationship with God. And those people didn't have a relationship with God. Even the disciples themselves, they were all looking for a earthly Messiah, like all the Jews. They didn't quite understand why Jesus came. But Jesus came for something greater than just to meet our physical needs. He came to meet our greatest need. We are currently in a... when we were all born, there is no one righteous, not one. And like Nathan was saying in our group today, recently there was an earthquake in the last couple of months, and their house shook, and he was afraid. Anyone would be afraid if your house is shaking, and you think, the house is going to fall on me, and I'm going to die. That's scary. But that's actually... things like that, trials, help us to start thinking about what actually matters in this life. And point number one, nothing matters apart from God. But point number two, everything begins to matter with God. Look at me at the verses again in Ecclesiastes, starting in verse 3. If you know God, if you have a relationship with God, then everything begins to matter. What advantage does man have in all his work in which he labors under the sun, but with God? Verse 4. A generation goes and a generation comes, but the earth stands forever. Though the old people pass away and the new children are born and grow up, if you know God, God knows you. Every single person, every single name in the genealogies that you don't want to read in the Old and New Testament, they were a life made in God's image that God knew from the moment they took their first breath, even before they took their first breath, while they're in their mother's womb. Stomach, all the way the life they lived. If it was a life lived with God, walking with God, then every second mattered. Every second had a purpose, had a meaning, and has joy. Verse 5, also the sun rises and the sun sets. It seems like to the person who doesn't know God, it's useless. It's just going over and over again, rotating. But you know, if you're a Christian, God put that sun there to provide light, to provide life, so that we can have vegetation, so that we can, the whole world can still move and live and breathe. Imagine if God just kept the sun up there today at 1 o'clock for the rest of time. We would all fry up at 110 degrees and plus. But God, in his perfect wisdom, he has the sun going up and down in the right time so that we can experience life and have life. Even God's goodness happens in the moving of the sun. Verse 6, the wind seems to blow around and has no purpose, has no meaning. Think back with me to the previous passage we studied in Mark chapter 6, when Jesus walked on water. Even at that very perfect time, with the sun down so that it's dark and the disciples can't see much, and the wind was blowing against them, so they were working hard for many, many hours trying to row to the other side. God had put that wind, put the waves there at the perfect time for the disciples to not be able to make any headway, to think they were in danger to die, for him to show up and then reveal himself again a little more to his disciples that I am God. Even every second, even every wind, it seems meaningless. God has a purpose in every gust, every blow of wind. In verse 7, all the rivers go into the sea, yet the sea is not full. There's a reason why we know why rivers run into the ocean. The purpose isn't to fill up the ocean. There's a purpose to it. It's to water all the vegetation, to provide life and drinking water to everything that goes through. Suddenly, once you know God, everything is new. Everything has meaning. Before, all things are worrisome. Man is not able to speak of it. You're never satisfied. Now we know every time we eat, every time we drink, every time we do anything in this life, even me taking a step right here, I know that was a gift from God. He provided me the legs to move, to feel, to be able to know this is left, this is right. If I didn't know direction, then I'd just start walking to things. But God made an ordered world. He made all things good. And suddenly, every breath you breathe in, every beat of your heart begins to have meaning. And you give thanks to God for every second of your life because you know God. Everything begins to matter when you know God. That which has been done is that which will be, and that which has been done is that which will be done. But then you realize, even reading the Bible, history, all Israelite history, from when God created the universe to Adam, all the way to Solomon here and to the future, every single person mattered. Every single action they took, whether it was to worship God and to follow him, or to live apart from God and to reject him, has a purpose in the history with God. Suddenly, every action has meaning. Every action has a purpose. Every second is new in this life. There's not ever going to be another Jesse in 10 years, 100 years like him, with living the same perfect life and background that you went through and the decisions you're making today. There's not going to be a new Jesse, only one Jesse. And even in heaven, there's only going to be one Jesse in heaven. No one to replace him for who he is. Then finally, there is no remembrance of earlier things. In a life apart from God, or where you do not know God in a relationship, you don't remember the things that are the things in the past, and the things in the future really don't matter. They have no purpose. But when you know God's plan of salvation from beginning to end, to give him the glory, when you know him and know the Bible, then every single action has a purpose. And there's actually going to be one thing that we will remember. At this point in Mark 6, the disciples don't understand. The crowds don't even understand. They all miss the point, even the disciples. But Jesus, we see his perfect compassion. We see his patience. And this is the change that will make us go from nothing matters to everything matters. You need to understand this point. It's not just to trust and obey God. Yes, it is. It actually begins with trusting God. But it's not based on an action that we do. In this passage in Mark 6, the crowd was asking, begging Jesus, can we even just touch the part of your garment? They were asking Jesus not for what he could do for them, but they were asking, let us do something, take an action so that we can gain something. But what God gives to us is something we cannot earn on our own. It's called faith. It's believing in the promises of God. It's what Solomon believed at the end of his life, though he lived a life that was wasted. it wasn't all wasted. God used them to leave the books of Proverbs, Song of Songs, Ecclesiastes, to help future generations know, as the preacher in verse 1, that he's telling them, this is how you can live a life of wisdom, how you can truly know God and live a purposeful life. And for Jesus and his patience and his kindness, though the people approached him not knowing who he was, are coming to him for the wrong motives for wanting to be healed, Jesus was patient. Remember, again, this is God in the flesh. Jesus is so patient, so loving, that he's standing among people who don't care about him, and honestly, many of them would go on to reject him. There's over 500,000 people in Jerusalem, in Judea. How many were saved at Pentecost? 3,000, less than 1% of the total number of population of the area. And yet God would come down, leave his throne in heaven above, become a man, born a man like those, like the crowds, like those people. And he came to be touched by them, to be known by them. Though they didn't understand now, though the disciples would not understand now, eventually, as they see him and as he continues to be patient with them, teaching them, he would show them the greatest form of love, greatest way to help them to understand why he came, by dying on the cross, helping them to see they could be healed, they could be fed, they could have eternal life at the cost of his life, of the perfect one, the good one, dying for the sins of all who would believe in him. And Jesus didn't just die. He rose from the dead 3 days later. And he, before he left for heaven, he left with us the helper, the counselor, the Holy Spirit, to help us to understand. Now we have something that Solomon did not have. Now we have something the disciples did not have at the time. We have the whole Bible. We have the Holy Spirit. We can now truly understand God's compassion, God's love, in a way that we couldn't understand before. So trust in Jesus. Come to know him, reflect on, think on the way he has loved us. And that is how we can go from nothing matters in this life to every single action, every single experience you go through, both the joys, both the sorrows, both all the happy experiences like marriage and the relationship of marriage, to even the trials of losing your family, loved one, having cancer, sickness, tragedy happening at your house burns down. Anything good, anything bad is in the control of our perfect Heavenly Father, and he is good, and he's patient with us, and he allows all these things to happen in our lives so that we would also come to understand and know that every single thing does matter when we understand that God is in control, and when you have a relationship with God, which we can have if you trust in Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And as a Christian, then meditate, think on the compassion of God towards us, and that will give us more compassion towards the next time someone cuts you off on the freeway, the next time you have an argument with your spouse, the next time the unbeliever does things that annoy you. Remember again of who we once were. We lived a life apart from God. We didn't care about God at all. It's like the person in the dungeon, locked in a dark dungeon, the doors close, the chains are around our hands and our feet, but we're happy there. We want to be in our sin. We want to be in the darkness. But then God shone the light in our lives through his son, Jesus Christ, through the Bible, to make the chains fall off, to make the door open, and we're free. But sometimes as Christians, we still seem to want to stay in the dungeon. Though the door is wide open, though the chains are gone, of our slavery to sin, and the light is right there, we still choose to turn away from God and choose to indulge in all those things, good things even, family, friends, food, fellowship, but apart from God, glorifying God in those things. And yet God is so patient. He reminds us again that he's here. And that's why we have Bible studies. That's why we get together and remind ourselves of God's compassion, God's love towards us. So praise God for that. And let us pray now and thank God for what we're about to enjoy for the rest of the evening. Almighty Father, you are good. Thank you for the reminder again that everything is meaningless apart from you. Forgive us, Father, when we seek happiness from anything else besides you. But thank you that now that we know you, everything we can enjoy in this life, we can enjoy with purpose. We can enjoy them as gifts from a loving Father, gifts from the perfect giver of all these things. Father, would you help us to examine our lives and see if we have been like the crowd, missing the point, coming to you for the wrong reason. Even now, the things we desire, good things in this life, for the kids to grow up and have a good life, for a relationship, for those who desire marriage, for a better job to better provide for a family. All these things are good, but apart from you, they are meaningless. There is no reason, there is no purpose for them. And in fact, it's all just a sin, a rebellion against you when we do those things apart from you. But thank you for the compassion of your Son, Jesus. Would you help us to reflect on these things? Help us to see the gloriousness of our God and Savior and what He's done. There's no one like you. We are not patient like you. We don't love others like you do. Thank you for showing us how great your Son Jesus is, that even though we are the most evil of evil people, though we reject you, even as Christians, we often sin against you. And yet Jesus knew all that and already paid it all on the cross. What a love, what a Savior. And help us to look forward to the day when we will be in heaven with you forever, the times when we will see the scars on your hand, the scars on your feet and your side, and remember for all eternity the one thing that saved us, of when you went to the cross to take the Father's wrath on yourself in our place. Father, help us to remember and to give you glory. We pray and ask all this in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.